Hi everyone, welcome to another episode of Gaffering Gear. In today's episode, we're going to take a look at the Nanlux Evoke 1200. We're going to take a look at the FL35 Fresnel that's available for it. We're going to take a look at the different dish options that you can get, as well as take a look at some of the soft boxes that are here. All right, let's get into it. Now, before we get underway, a very big thank you to Protog, the Australian distributor of Nanlux, for supplying us with today's product. Now, because we are covering a lot of detail in this episode, there is a time-coded index in the description, so you can skip the sections that you're not interested in. All right, so let's very quickly introduce you to the light. So it's a 1200 watt COB system. So by system, I mean the total power draw, maximum power draw is 1200 watt, not the COB itself. So it's very, very bright. It's daylight only. Now, it's not a Bowen mount. So that's one thing I'll point out. It's got its own mounting system because the COB is quite large. Now, I think they've done the right thing having their own mounting system because Bowen mount is a little bit flimsy on accessories this big. Now, the first negative for me is the head with nothing attached to it isn't as bright as I was hoping for. Now, I was expecting it to be 120% brighter than, say, a Forza 500 with nothing attached. 500 watts versus 1,200 watts. That's sort of what I was expecting. Now, this thing only comes in at about 90% brighter than a Forza 500 head. The next negative for me is the size of the setup here. So if you're looking to use it attached to the Fresnel, how much space this takes up relative to how much light you get is a big negative for me. Now, I'm going to explain what I mean by that. If I want to put this in my lighting van, I have to take something else out in order for this to fit in. Now, this is the size of about an M40, but it only delivers less light than an M18. So relative to how much space it takes up in a lighting vehicle, it doesn't deliver that much light. Now, the next negative for me is the cooling fans. So underneath, it's got a gigantic cooling fan, which is very quiet. But on the top, it's got this PC computer style little cooling fan, which is actually quite loud. So that's quite disappointing. The next negative for me is the position of the controls. The controls are on the head. So if you've got this high up on a lighting stand, you won't be able to reach the controls. Now, it does have a little port here for a controller, but as far as I know, that hasn't been released yet. The next negative is you can't do an instant blackout with this light. The phosphor has an extended decay rate. Now, the next negative for me is the length of the head lead. Now, the head lead is 5 meters long. Now, I have Forza 500s and they have 5 meter head leads. And that is plenty of length on a Forza 500 because on the Forza 500, you can mount the power supply and the controller to the light stand, whereas you can't do that with this unit. So it has to be on the ground. And that additional bit of length makes the head lead just that little bit shorter than I would like. Now, the next negative for me is the balance point here on the Fresnel when you've got everything attached. So at the moment, it's pretty well balanced. So I've got it unlocked and it's not too bad. Okay, I'm being very brave here. But if I put it into flood, it's currently in spot. If I put it into flood, it becomes very, very front heavy. So the next negative isn't just the fact that it's front heavy, it's where the stirrup is mounted to the Fresnel. The stirrup's mounted underneath here instead of centralized. So when it does go forwards, it lurches quite a bit. Okay, so it's got quite a bit of lurch to it. So if you are on a ladder, for example, doing adjustments and you weren't expecting this to really lurch forwards, it could pull you off the ladder. Okay, let's go through some of the pros now. And I will start off with the Fresnel, having just criticized it quite a bit for its size. It does have beautiful optics. It's got a very even beam, and I really like the shadows and the barn door cuts. Now, I would go as far as to say that this is probably the second best in terms of optics, the second best LED Fresnel that I've reviewed. Now, the best is the Felix by a long shot. I reckon Felix is the gold standard when it comes to Fresnels, but this thing is very reminiscent for me of large studio 2Ks and large studio 5Ks in terms of how even the beam is. Now, the next thing for this is the spot. It spots from 45 degrees all the way down to 11 degrees. and that gives you a heap of firepower at 11 degrees. So I measure 49,600 lux at 3 meters. So that's quite substantial. Now, the next positive for me is the overall build quality of everything. Everything is built really, really strong. So absolutely built to withstand the rigors of a professional environment. The next professional thing for me, or the next thing I really like, is the unit is IP54 rated. So you can use it outdoors in the rain. And not just the head, you can also use the power supply outdoors in the rain. As long as it's not that way up, you have to have it orientated the correct way around. Now, the overwhelming big positive for this system is how much light level you get in conjunction with the dishes. Now, these dishes are very differently designed to your standard bow and mount dish. So this is a 45 degree dish, and this is the Nanlux 45 degree dish. And as you can see, the Nanlux is bigger. So on these standard size dishes, you get a lot of drop off on either side of the beam. So you get your 45 degree beam angle and then a load of drop off on the other sides. But with this dish here, the extra bit of length takes that light that would have been drop off and bounces it back into your 45 degrees. So not only do these things give me the most even beam I've seen on a dish, but they give you a huge amount of light output. The 60 degree dish comes in at 9% brighter than an M18 set to the same beam angle. And with the 45 degree dish, it came in at 97% the brightness of an M18 set to the matching angle. Now, what really surprised me with these reflectors is when I put them through a window. Now, you can't barn door cut these like you can a Fresnel, but the 60 degree dish had shadows that were very much like a Fresnel. Now, the 45 degree dish wasn't quite as sharp, but still, I was very surprised by the shadow qualities. Way better than anything I'd get on an M18, and definitely better than the flood lenses on a HMI PAR. With the 26 degree dish, the shadows were more like I was expecting. And of course, the last big plus for me is CRMX control. All right, so let's go through what everything costs and what you get for your money. And because there's quite a few bits and pieces here today, and it's not all sold as a kit, when I get to the individual items, I'll go through the pros and cons and go through the data that I've collected on them. All right, so let's start off with the basic kit, your startup package. All right, so one thing you don't get is a carry bag. So you can get transport cases separately, but it doesn't come with a bag. So we'll just go through what you get for that money. So you get a stirrup. So the stirrup is removable from the light, and you can use this stirrup to mount the light, or the Fresnel can mount to this, and then you mount the light to the Fresnel. Now, I've got a couple of negatives with this. So first off is it's a rosette system. I hate rosettes. The next negative for me is you can put the Fresnel on with the lock off on the left. Sorry, this is the right. With the lock off on the right or on the left. So why is that a negative? Well, the Fresnel is very front heavy, and if you've got the lock off on the left side, then you've got the locking organized or orientated left to loosen. So it could come loose and fall forwards. All right, next thing we'll talk about is the light itself. So let's get that on the stirrup and start having a chat. All right, now when you put it onto the stirrup, you have this little red indicator on the latch, which means you're not locked. So that's a warning. So you flick those up and you are now locked in place. Now to unlock it, press the blue button and that will release the latch. All right, I'm not going to go through the menu system in today's episode because it is really straightforward to use. So if you can cross the road without someone holding your hand, you can use this light. There's no point. All right, now it does come with the usual special effects that we've come accustomed to having in a good COB light. So things like pulsing, strobes, lightning effect, welding effect, pulsing, things like that. I think I've said pulsing twice. All right, so on the back here, you've got a USB port. You've got a DMX in and a DMX out, and you've got your power inlet. All right, so let's talk about brightness of the head straight away. Okay, so at 3 meters, I measured 4,390 lux. Now that probably doesn't mean anything for you, so I've given you some comparisons. So compared to HMIs, it comes in 36% brighter than a 575 HMI Fresnel in flood. And it comes in at 96% the brightness of an M8 set to flood. Now, bear in mind, that's like it is here, bare COB, nothing attached. Now, comparing it to other LED lights, it comes in 90% brighter than a Forza 500 and 48% brighter than an aperture 600D. Now the light has a very large display, so you can easily see what you're adjusting. It is dimmable in 0.1% increments and the buttons are backlit. Now the light also has Lumen Radio wireless DMX built into it. All right, let's go through what I found with my testing.
At 100% brightness, I got 5,512 Kelvin with an SSI score of 75. The TM30 color scores were 94% accuracy with 102% saturation. Here are the CRI scores and only R12 is below 90. This is the spectral distribution. And the white point came in with a delta UV of minus 0.0014, which means the light is slightly magenta to less than a 1/8 correction gel off the Plankine curve and a bit more than a 1/8 correction gel off the daylight curve. At 50% brightness, I got 5,454 Kelvin with an SSI score of 74. The TM30 color vector testing came in at 94% accuracy with a 102% saturation. Here are the CRI scores and only R12 is below 90. This is the spectrum distribution. The white point comes in with a delta UV of minus 0.0006, which places it very close to the Plankine curve, but compared to the daylight curve, the light is magenta by about the equivalent of a 1/8 correction gel. At 10% brightness, I got 5,427 Kelvin with an SSI score of 73. TM30 color vector testing came in at 94% color accuracy with an average 102% saturation. Here are the CRI scores and only R12 is below 90. This is the spectrum distribution and the delta UV came in at minus 0.0002, which puts it almost on top of the Plankine curve, but compared to the daylight curve, it's slightly magenta to about the equivalent of a 1/8 correction gel.
Now you also get a Nutrix power cable and you get the head lead. So the head lead's 5 meters. So I think every gaffer would be happier with maybe another 2.5 meters. All right, it's got the same connector at both ends. Okay, so you can't link them together, but on the bright side, it's idiot proof. You can't connect the wrong side into the wrong end. So I've had a few people do that on rentals. It takes a lot of force to push pins into pins, but people manage to do it. All right, and it's a simple push button release. So this is about as idiot proof as you can get a head lead cable. That's the positive spin on it. I just wish it was 2.5 meters longer. All right, possibly they've got a longer one coming. All right, now let's get into the PSU, the power supply unit. So this power supply consists of two Meanwell 600 watt DC power supplies that are linked together to give you a 1200 watts. On the front here, we have the connection for the head lead there, and we have our Nutrix power in. Now the on-off switch here is a DC on-off switch. That's only switching the power off on the DC out. All right, so let's go through the data I've collected for the power supply. The maximum power draw that I was able to meter, and that was done automatically over several days. My meter kept recording results. The maximum power draw I recorded was 1,084 watt. So that's a bit under the 1200 watt that I was expecting. It's typically pulling about 1071 watt. Now, those readings are backed up by my generators, which tell me a similar sort of thing. All right, now in terms of things like your power factor, at 100% brightness, it is running at a power factor unity of 0.96%. So that means it'll run nicely off a small portable generator that has an inverter control system. Now, running at 10% brightness, that power unity drops to 0.61%, which is typical of LEDs running with pulse width modulated dimming. Now, the last thing that comes in the standard kit is a 45 degree reflector. And these are easily the best reflectors I've come across for testing. So let me try and illustrate to you how good these reflectors are. So I'm going to put it in front of the light, which is black, and point it at the camera. Now, watch what happens when I put this piece of paper in behind. See how that paper is reflected on every single facet on that reflector. So the alignment in these things really is second to none. Okay, so now let's talk about the brightness. So at 3 meters, I got 14,300 lux. Now to compare that with HMIs, it comes in at 20% brighter than a 2.5K HMI Fresnel set to full flood. And it comes in at 97% the brightness of an M18 set to the same beam angle. And comparing it to another COB light, it comes in at 121% the brightness of a Forza 500 with its 45 degree dish on.
I got 5,551 Kelvin with an SSI score of 74%. The TM30 color vector testing came in at 94% color accuracy with a 102% saturation. Here are the CRI scores, and only R12 is below 90. This is the spectrum distribution, and the delta UV came in at minus 0.0018, which means compared to the Plankian curve, it is magenta by under a 1/8 correction gel, and compared to the daylight curve, it is magenta by somewhere between a 1/8 correction gel and a 1/4 correction gel.
The next thing we'll have a look at is the 60 degree dish. Now this dish sells for, and these are some prices I found, 49 euros, 89 Australian dollars and 88 US dollars. So it's so cheap, you might as well have it. Same build quality as the previous dish. Now, one negative with this dish, I think it must be due to the way that the optics throw the light out. This thing's really hard to gel. So with the 45 degree, you could tape some gel to the front and you'd be okay. This thing's a gel melter, so you'd have to be about that far off from the front to stop your gels from melting, even with a heat shield. All right, so with this, I got 10,400 lux. So to give you some comparisons, that's 9% brighter than an M18 HMI set to the same beam angle. Comparing it to other LED COB lights, that's 61% brighter than a Forza 500 with its 45 degree dish. And bear in mind that this thing is throwing out a beam angle 1/3 wider, and it is 4% brighter than the Aperture 600D with its F10 Fresnel. Now bear in mind once again that this is supplying a beam 1/3 wider. Now let's take a look at the 26 degree reflector, and something I forgot to mention, the additional reflectors do come with their own bags. So the 26 degree reflector here, it is huge, it's massive, so storing it could be a bit of an issue. Now with the 26 degree reflector on, I got 41,000 lux at 3 meters. Now the CCT did drop a little. I got 5,327 Kelvin. The SSI score came in at 75. The TM30 color vector testing results were 94% color accuracy with a 102% saturation. Here are the CRI scores, only R12 was below 90. This is the spectrum distribution. And the delta UV was a little bit further off, coming in at minus 0.0020, which makes it magenta to almost the equivalent of a 1/8 correction gel from the Plankian curve and almost a 1/4 correction gel off the daylight curve. All right, now let's have a look at the FL35, their Fresnel attachment. So 35 refers to the fact that it's a 35 centimeter lens. All right, now one thing I do like about this straight away is it has skids on the bottom or mounts. So you can put this in your truck on a shelf with the light attached to it. It's not gonna roll around. All right, now it doesn't come with a stirrup or a yoke. It uses the yoke that is on the light. So pros and cons, I don't like the way it's balanced. I've already gone through that, but if you're not particularly strong or you've got to the end of the day and you're exhausted, you can break the system down when you assemble it and disassemble it. So for example, I don't have to have the weight of the whole unit. I can just have the weight of the Fresnel here and mount that onto the stirrup. Now just make sure that's locked. And then I can mount the light to the back. Now this Fresnel is very different to other Fresnels in terms of how it floods spots. Instead of having the lens moving forwards and backwards, it moves the light in and out of the center of the Fresnel. Now on the outside ring here, you've got your diameter of your beam, which is indicated by the little blue marker here. So as I spot this up, you can see the blue marker moving. So that's 18 degrees there, that's 20 degrees there, and so on. Now in full flood, it's 45 degrees, and it spots all the way around to 11 degrees. Now one last thing I almost forgot to mention with the Fresnel, the one thing that concerned me when I first saw the design was the stirrups at the bottom. So what does that mean in terms of putting it into a lighting grid? Does that mean the light has to be upside down and probably won't ventilate? Well, no, because you can actually put the light on upside down. So if this thing was rigged upside down in a lighting grid, as in the stirrup is at the top, the light would be the correct way up and would be able to ventilate. Now let's give you some stats for this thing in flood. So I got 11,100 lux at 3 meters. Now, to give you some comparisons, that's 93% the brightness of a 2.5K HMI Fresnel set to full flood. And it works out to about 75% the brightness of an M18 set to a matching 45 degree beam angle. Compared to a Forza 500 with its Fresnel in full flood, it's 118% brighter. But when compared to an Aperture 600D with its F10 Fresnel, this only comes in at 11% brighter. Flood is only half the story. Let's talk about this thing in spot now. So in spot, I got 49,600 lux at 3 meters. So to give you some comparisons, that's 79% the brightness of a M18 HMI set to full spot. It's 2.4 times brighter than a Forza 500 with its Fresnel set to full spot. And it's 67% brighter than the 600D with the F10 set to spot. Now, if you're thinking of storing this in your truck or in your van fully assembled, I just wanted to show you the size of it. So this is with it, the head in flood, so it's compacted in. You've got a carry handle on top and a carry handle on the back. Now, it's the weight's a little bit uneven in the distribution, but you could even that up by having it in the spot position, which of course makes the unit a bit bigger for storage, but it does even up the weight, makes it a lot easier to carry around. So, you know, it depends if you want curvature in your spine when you're old or not, but really it's quite big. Now, you could take, you know, the stirrup off and save this little bit of space in terms of storage, but putting the stirrup on and taking the stirrup on and off would be a bit of a pain, I think. So that's pretty much the length of the unit compacted up for storage.
Now with the Fresnel on, I got 5612 Kelvin with an SSI score of 74. The TM color vector results were 94% color accuracy with 102% saturation. Here are the CRI scores, and only R12 is below 90. Here is the spectrum distribution, and the delta UV comes in at minus 0.0017, which makes it slightly magenta to less than a 1/8 gel correction from the Plankian curve and less than a 1/4 correction from the daylight curve.
All right, so just a few more things to look at and then we're done. So we'll have a look at the two softbox options and then how this thing responds to Lumen Radio DMX. All right, so in the bag here is their Parabolic 150. So that's a 150 centimeter front on a Parabolic softbox. So beautifully circular. Now, this comes with a grid, but unfortunately, the grid's absolute rubbish. It's got very thin walls combined with massive cells. So it actually doesn't cut the beam all that well. Now, as you can see in this shot here, it's doing very little to reduce the beam angle at all. And when I put my hand next to the softbox at about 170 degree angle, it's still illuminated. Now it comes with two choices of diffuser. So you've got a grid cloth. Now I don't quite recognize the density on that. So I think it's somewhere between what's a quarter and what is a half normally. So it's not bad, it's a good material. And it comes with this other diffuser, which is a little bit like a magic cloth, except it has a little bit of grain detail in it. So two very good diffusers. Now the stirrup system on the Evoke can easily take the weight of this softbox. And the speed ring has a quick release system for easy setup. All of the stitching, the material and the Velcro is really high quality. The reflector material is very neutral, but like with all Parabolics with COBs, it's a bit dark in the center. Now this is what it looks like with the full diffusion if you expose for the hot spots, and with the grid cloth you do have a bit of grain texture as well. Now with the full diffusion on at 1 meter, I got 10,400 lux and a CCT of 5,406, and at 3 meters I got 2,240 lux with a CCT of 5,303. With the light diffusion I gained 1/3 more brightness. At 1 meter I got 13,800 lux with a CCT of 5,525 Kelvin, and at 3 meters I got 3,950 lux with a CCT of 5,411 Kelvin. Now the last accessory we'll take a look at is the Octagonal 150, which is essentially a more of a traditional octadome unit. Now it's much smaller packed down than the previous unit. It's built of the same quality materials, but it has a skinnier profile. Now in terms of it lighting the front diffusion well, it achieves this through having a white dish in the center. As you can see here with the full diffuser, this actually does a really good job of getting an even distribution over that front surface, despite the fact that it has a slim profile. Now this unit sells for 419 AUD and 299 USD. Now here are some quick stats. With the full diffusion at 1 meter, I got 12,000 lux with a CCT of 5,371. At 3 meters, I got 2,350 lux with a CCT of 5,294. Now with the grid cloth diffusion at 1 meter, I got 13,500 lux with a CCT of 5,504. And at 3 meters, I got 3,120 lux with a CCT of 5,460. All right, so let's get around to testing the Lumen Radio DMX now. So let's go into the menu system. All right, so DMX is our first option that's up there, address DMX, so let's click on that. So you've got a choice of your address, that's pretty straightforward. DMX mode, so that's your profile, so we click on that. You've got 8-bit, 16-bit, and ultimate mode. So the ultimate 8-bit mode allows you to run your special effects but uses more channels. So I'm just gonna go with the 8-bit mode, the daylight 8-bit mode. Now that uses two channels. So channel one is your brightness, of course. And look at this, it has beautiful smoothing programmed into it. So if you're using it on a console and you need to do very subtle adjustments, it's not going to shimmer and give your actors, you know, epileptic seizures. Channel two is your fan on off. So it turns the fan on and off. Now here's the problem. When you turn the fan off, the light only runs at 10% brightness. So pretty much a useless mode as far as I'm concerned. Okay, so let's go back into the DMX menu. And the last thing on the menu is your dimmer curve. So you've got linear, exponential, logarithmic, and S-curve. Now, something to point out here, I'm just gonna go back to linear. Something to point out here is if you select anything other than linear, the display values on the back for brightness are still the linear values. So that can lead to a bit of confusion between the values displayed on your console and the light. So if you've got differing values, the display is just showing you the linear and your dimmer curve might be set to something else. All right, so let's go back into the menu system, have a look down. Now, Lumen Radio settings, let's click on that. Radio mode, okay. Now we can select receiver or transmitter mode because this obviously has a TMO2 module in it. Now, if we go transmitter mode, it gives you a warning telling you that the phone app might not work that great with this unit anymore because the receiver transmitter is going to interfere with the 2.4 gigahertz receiver that's for the phone app stuff or Bluetooth, whatever it runs off. All right, now in this mode here, we can select RF power. I don't know why you'd want to do that, but you can select that. And we've also got the link option so that we can link other devices to this as this being the transmitter. Now, in terms of feeding DMX into it, you have to feed the DMX cabled in for that to work. All right, so let's select this back to receiver mode, otherwise I won't be able to figure out what I've done wrong. Now let's see how it responds to Lumen Radio commands. Now, just a few things to note. When we do an instant off command, the light won't be able to go straight to black because of the decay rate that's in the LED light emitters. And the next thing to note is when you're doing a fade to black, when you're just kissing that 0%, it seems to do this weird sort of hover and fall over thing, but I don't think that's going to show up if you're exposing for a bright level, which is why you'd be using this in the first place, because, you know, 1 or 2% of that isn't very bright, so I don't think it's going to show up. Anyway, I'm talking too much. Let's have a look. So let's swing across to this light and do instant on off commands. So it goes instantly on, okay, but it can't do an instant off. Okay, let's do a 5-second fade to black. Let's do a 5-second fade up. The fade ups are beautiful. You could easily do a fade up from black, no problem at all. All right, let's go 2.5 seconds, fading down. And fading up. The fade ups are beautiful. On the fade downs, it has that little step, but I don't think it's going to show up. Okay, let's go to 1 second now. Fading down. And fading up. And And let's push our luck. Let's go to half a second on the fade time. And fading down. And fading up. All right, so that's another episode of Gaffer and Gear. And geez, I tell you what, this was a really hard episode to do. It was a lot of data to collect and a lot of testing. And I wasn't just doing all this testing for you guys. As a working gaffer, I was doing this testing for me as well, because 1200 watt COBs are here and we need to figure out what we're going to buy if we're going to buy. So that's why I've given you so much data. And as you can see, it's not a straightforward yes or no. So for me personally, the Fresnel for this doesn't make any sense. It's such a big unit and it only gives me 11% more brightness than my 600D with its F10. So, which I already own. So it doesn't make sense for me to have that. And I don't think I'd use this through a softbox, me personally. I'd probably use this through a frame or something like that. But this sort of setup here, so the light, 60 degree dish, 45 degree dish, this makes sense to me. I'm gonna have to have a serious think about, you know, getting a couple of these, because this does for me what an M18 through a window does, except I get dim ability and I get lumen radio control. So, and it doesn't take up that much space. So that's a pretty slim kit in terms of what goes onto my shelf. So I'm gonna really have a hard think about this. This might be my purchase. Anyway, see you on the next episode.